Hi, I'm Bob Gimlin.
The saga of what has come to be known as the Enfield Monster, or horror, took place in Enfield, Illinois, in 1973. Like many of the musty corridors of Fortean lore, this particular flap leaves more questions than answers, and the explanations range from the likely to the impossible, though the definitions of those words seem to vary greatly depending on who you ask. And before I get into it, I do want to note that the events of Enfield, Illinois, that came to be known as the Enfield Monster or Horror, are not related to the Enfield Haunting, or Poltergeist, which occurred in Enfield, London, some 5 years later. In Enfield, Illinois, on April 25th, 1973, at 10 p.m., Henry McDaniel arrived home from working late. McDaniel worked in the sale and restoration of antique furniture, but perhaps more importantly, he was a single father of two children, ages 12 and 15. Upon arriving home, he immediately found it strange that the lights were on and all the curtains were drawn shut. Usually his children were in bed by then. Upon entering the house, he found his two children in a state of hysteria. They said something had been trying to get into the house, first by scratching at the door, and then by trying to dislodge a window-mounted air conditioning unit. As you could imagine, McDaniel was skeptical, but he noticed that the air conditioner was in fact out of place. And the two kids, no doubt energetically, further explained that it had just happened, as in, while he was in the driveway. It was outside with him, beside the house. Obviously curious, McDaniel went to the front door from which he had just entered, and upon opening it, indeed, he saw a creature approaching the steps of the front porch. The next day, McDaniel would tell the Mount Vernon Register News that the creature, quote, had three legs on it, a short body, two little short arms coming out of its breast area, and two pink eyes as big as flashlights. It stood 4.5 feet tall and was grayish colored. He said it was heading for the door as if it was in fact looking for entrance. In a condition of understandable surprise, McDaniel slammed shut the door and retrieved a .22 caliber pistol from a box in the coat closet. He returned to the door with the weapon ready, and it was closer now. Only a step away from the stairs. McDaniel shot it. He said, quote, when I fired that first shot, I know I hit it. It hissed like a wild cat. Then he said the impossible visitor lunged off toward a row of trees, covering 50 feet in 3 bounds. So that's 17 feet per bound. McDaniel fired 4 more times, but doesn't believe he hit it, as he only had a handgun, and it bounded into the night, and the night was dark. Henry McDaniel called the police. And it was just before midnight when 2 state troopers arrived, and though no creature was to be found, they indeed found strange tracks. They described the tracks as similar to a dog, though with 6 pads instead of 5, and that, though indistinct, the tracks did in fact seem strangely spaced, consistent with an abnormal gait, which obviously an alleged triped would possess. And I'm showing this graphic of a dog because in the past, I've mentioned that dogs have 5 pads. And commenters have said that they only have 4, but the bottom pad is considered a pad. Anyway, one of the officers, a man by the name of James Masser, said that McDaniel seemed, quote, rational and sober, and the police mentioned in their report that indeed they believed something unusual visited the McDaniel residence, and that they were prepared to receive similar calls. The next day, Officer Masser visited other houses in the area. The only corroborating witness he could locate was a 10-year-old boy named Greg Garrett. He said that the night prior, at 8:30 p.m., Garrett was menaced by a creature that matched that of McDaniel's. So a couple hours before McDaniel's house was menaced, Garrett described the creature as possessing grayish slimy skin, short claws, and red eyes. He said that the creature stamped on his foot with its, quote, clawed appendages. It was just about the time that Masser was talking to little Greg when a few local reporters arrived to the McDaniel house. Remember, this was a time when your living room police scanner was better than anything on the tube. Press and, quote, experts were apparently working under a theory that McDaniel saw a kangaroo, a 4-foot-tall kangaroo. All done. Video over. But seriously, to be fair, the notion that he saw a kangaroo is almost reasonable. But personally, I would put emphasis on the word almost. According to the skeptic, at least, it would explain why the creature had 3 legs, as kangaroos use their tails as something like a 3rd leg, and not just for balance like most animals. A kangaroo would also explain the claws, and the observation that the creature's arms stuck straight out at the shoulders. and it would obviously explain the creature being able to cover 50 feet in 3 bounds. Also, I guess, I would assume that part of the reasoning was that if it was a kangaroo, then it was an escaped or abandoned pet, and therefore may feasibly try to break into a house if it only knew how to get food from people. And kangaroo tracks are certainly unique, but nothing about them is six-toed. However, McDaniel kind of had the ultimate response, and said that when he was in the army, he was stationed in Australia, and that at the base he stayed at, the kangaroos acted like pets. So he was quite certain that he did not see one. The small town life was obviously abuzz with tell of this strangeness, particularly because McDaniel, the antique dealer, veteran, and father of two, was not known to be a joker, prankster, or anything less than a reputable and decent human being. And apparently, no one had any reason to doubt that he was anything other than a competent observer. One could argue that he was, in fact, a competent observer. Because if he was, then the town had damn good reason to be interested. 2 weeks later, on May 7th, McDaniel called a radio station based out of Kokomo, Indiana. McDaniel said he saw the creature yet again. This time, it was moseying down some abandoned railroad tracks near his house. He said he didn't shoot at it, though he could have. He described it as the same as his initial encounter, and he said it wasn't in a hurry. WWKI's news director Rick Rainbow arrived on the scene. Strangely enough, he and his cameraman saw what they described as, quote, an ape-like figure walking around an abandoned building. They weren't prepared to film yet, but they followed it to the best of their ability. And though the creature never came into frame, they captured bizarre audio, like a woman's scream and baby laughter. As far as I can tell, to my disappointment, the audio has never been uploaded to the internet, or even digitized. But a few years after the audio was taken, cryptozoologist Lauren Coleman acquired the footage and audio, and I suppose it remains in his collection. So I have no way to play the audio for you, or even to listen to it myself. But I suspect the audio is quite chilling, knowing the context. The footage is of the two men walking through the woods. And I'm sure that everyone and their mom would know exactly what's making the call, but only a small percentage of the lot would be correct. 2 days after Rick Rainbow saw his ape-like figure, he met with McDaniel in the studio for an interview. He stuck to his resolution that the subject in question was something aberrant. That evening, the night of May 10th, police responded to gunfire in the forest. They found a posse of 5 men, armed to the teeth and drunk as skunks. The posse said that they had just had a close encounter with the monster, and that they were this close to blowing it back to Mars. The men were charged with hunting violations and were told that they would be arrested if they didn't vacate, which they did. The White County Sheriff's Office dismissed that they were doing anything other than partying with guns, and that they would have been doing the same thing whether or not there was a monster. And monster or not, it sounds like a good way to spend the night. All sorts of out-of-town and strange people flooded the area, though it doesn't seem that McDaniel interacted with many of them. It tried to come into the McDaniel home on April 25th, and he saw it on the railroad tracks on May 7th. The evening of May 8th was when Rick Rainbow saw his ape-like figure and captured the screams, and the Monster Hunters incident was on May 10th, Monster Hunter, in quotes or otherwise. And apparently, that was quite enough for one Mrs. Garrett. Because on May 15th, an allegedly contrite, and no doubt supervised, 10-year-old Greg Garrett phoned researchers from Western Illinois University, and he said he'd made up the whole story of the phantom shoe stomper. He said that he just wanted to, quote, tease Mr. McDaniel and have fun with out-of-town newsmen, both of which are little sins for a 10-year-old. And on that note, if you're a self-respecting 10-year-old boy, and a policeman stops you to ask if you've seen a 3-legged monster, you just say yes. Those are the rules. Also, I guess he mentioned that he wanted new shoes, which is really quite entrepreneurial for a 10-year-old. Or anyone, really. As far as I can tell, that's the bare bones of the Enfield Monster flap. Okay, so that was a lot of stuff to happen in a short amount of time, so I'll summarize the timeline for you. First is the initial sighting, as would make sense. That's the night that McDaniel came home to find his children frightened, the night he claimed to see what many would call impossible. Then there's young Greg's account, then McDaniel's second sighting, then there's Rick Rainbow's sighting of an ape-like figure, and his audio capture of what sounded like, quote, a woman's scream and baby laughter, and then the Monster Hunters, in quotes or otherwise. As you could imagine, the skeptics have no shortage of explanations. Which would make sense, because skeptics are remarkably consistent in that regard, and it seems that the prevailing skeptic argument is one of fear-induced hysteria, though subsequent sociological papers and their peer-reviewed and prestigious pedestals have called it many things, because that's what they do. And I guess their argument is that McDaniel came home late, and that the combination of his children's fright and the messed with air conditioner drove him to such a terror that he was no longer capable of rational observation, and that when he opened that door, he was so further driven to cataclysmic fright by a kangaroo, deer, or dog that he perceived something ordinary as something impossible. Case closed. First of all, that's not at all what McDaniel actually said happened. He said that he thought it was funny that his kids were so freaked out over nothing, because they were new to being left home alone due to their age. He thought they just had the jitters, and I can certainly see why an adult parent would find that humorous. But he said that even the messed with AC unit only made him curious, not afraid. So it's not like he opened the door to investigate in a state of panic that could result in a misidentification, or an overly imaginative response. He opened the door expecting to see a dog or something. He was in the mindset of dispelling his kid's notion, not proving it, until he suddenly was. The skeptic's claim of some type of panic-induced misremembrance is half-cocked, particularly when considering that two police officers filed in their reports that he was, quote, rational and sober. Because if he was insane enough to confuse a kangaroo with this, one would think that he would still be in a state of extreme, exaggerated agitation when the police arrived. And perhaps now's the time to mention that he called the non-emergency number. And you know, the skeptic's point here is one of those things that kind of bothers me on a weird level, unrelated to cryptozoology or anything like that. The fear-induced misidentification theory bothers me because, I guess before I judge anyone, I tried to put myself in their shoes. And I don't care if I was quaking in my boots and shaking like a leaf with the daylight scared out of me. There's no imaginable way I'm going to mistake a dog, or even a kangaroo, for something like this. Never. And to me, I guess that's more laughable than the notion of any cryptid. So that's just one of the reasons why the skeptic argument bothers me. There was no mistake in identity here. They just don't have the nerve to call him a liar, and that's because there's actually no reason to believe he was lying. To call this a case of mistaken identity, to me, is nonsense. Maybe what I'm trying to say is that the skeptics may as well just suck it up, Buttercup, and call him either stupid beyond reason, insane, or a liar. Because that's what they're really saying. One of those things. But of course, the skeptic's problem is that there's no reason to believe that he was any of those things. And though I generally take community opinions with a grain of salt, it's at least worth a mention that the residents of Enfield regarded McDaniel as an involved father, which is notable because a single father was more rare back then, a widower, a hard worker, quiet, and certainly not known for his sense of humor. So because McDaniel was not frightened at all by the encounter, and because the police found him sober and rational, and because he was absolutely not known for this kind of behavior, I'll opine my skepticism toward the skeptic's opinion. And plus, just again on the misidentification thing, he shot it. And if he shot it, he aimed at it. And if he aimed at it, he saw it. And if he met his mark, which he claims to have, then one would think he saw it clearly. You know, you don't get your gun for a kangaroo, particularly if you're familiar with kangaroos, which McDaniel was. In summation, and I guess just in my opinion, there's really nothing to suggest that McDaniel saw anything other than what he saw. Except for the fact that what he saw was impossible. But I try not to give that word too much thought. And I guess that's my argument for the McDaniel sighting. Other than that it isn't, quote, possible, there's really no reason to disbelieve him, or regard him as anything other than a competent human person with eyeballs. I suppose next is little Greg. I hope you're still keeping on, Greg. Let's see, if you were 10 in 73, then you were born in 63, which means you're 58 years young. And just maybe you're out there listening. Life is short for all of us, but it's not really a fair distribution down the line. Anyway, his chapter likely shouldn't be taken with too much merit, because he specifically called a university to confess. Though it's worth noting that that seems to have been his mother's doing. And I don't know about you. I can recall apologizing for things that I didn't do from when I was about that age, and no one believed me because I was just a dumb kid. And I can only imagine a prudent, small-town Indiana 1970s mother, shocked and appalled that her son got mixed into this cluster, and I see how she may be determined to try and make it right. In short, we're likely seeing a forced confession here, and anything is possible. I suspect that such a call would have been made whether or not Greg actually saw such a creature. However, even if he did indeed have an encounter, I have no doubt that the shoe-stamping element was elaboration, and with motive, which is kind of great. Because that detail just doesn't make a lot of sense, as it seems unlikely that a clawed appendage could shear through his shoe without damaging his foot, and it also seems unlikely that a boy would allow himself to get so close to the creature without retreating, and failing that, said boy would probably need to be held down with force. And Greg said the creature didn't hurt him. But still, if you know anything about kids, you'll know that one false part does not invalidate the rest. Indeed, the boy cries wolf, but that doesn't mean there wasn't one. So technically, I think we have to dismiss Greg's sighting as nothing. But what can I say? I don't find it entirely unlikely that he saw something, and then he ran with it with vigor, as is always the way to approach life. We'll likely never know little Greg's side of the story for certain. But in my opinion, a 10-year-old in 1973, with the wisdom to, quote, have fun with out-of-town newsmen, is no doubt a wise man today. But I think we have to call Greg's encounter iffy at best. And I suppose next is Rick Rainbow. He spoke with McDaniel the day before his sighting. And of course, just to muddy the water, he didn't even see the McDaniel creature. He saw an ape-like figure, walking behind an abandoned building. And according to Mr. Rainbow, they weren't ready to film yet because they wanted to wait for nightfall, for the sake of cinematic suspense. But what they saw occurred in broad daylight. And though he and the cameraman never filmed or even saw the creature again, they followed it and picked up audio of a wailing sound. And like I said, it's unfortunate I can't find the audio to play for you, or indeed, to hear for myself, but I imagine it's eerie and undefinable. And even though some people would be able to, quote, prove what the sound is, that wouldn't make much of a difference to those who could prove it was something else. So are we to believe that Rick Rainbow had a Bigfoot sighting randomly during a monster flap? Maybe. Perhaps fitting for a man named Rick Rainbow, but as it goes for strangeness, when it rains, it pours. Some people may go so far as to say that doorways open between places, and that for reasons unclear and perhaps uncomfortable, things can come and go from them, and even bring people with them. And that's never been my technical opinion on the matter, but I certainly don't know what can't be known. Because Rainbow was steadfast in his conclusion, and because he at least picked something up on audio, I think there's decent enough reason to at least consider his sighting. Why not? Besides, a woman's screaming and a baby's laughter are a bit on the nose for what has been universally described for thousands of years, with no sign of abating. And then finally, what of the monster hunters? Well, see again, it's so easy to just hand all of this over to the skeptic, after the fact. But who is to say? If indeed Rainbow reportedly saw an ape-like figure and heard its screams, something that's been seen countless times before, and if McDaniel saw something impossible on two occasions, then perhaps a group of men went on the hunt, and maybe the feeling was mutual. You know what they say about looking into the darkness. Sometimes it looks back. And honestly, having recently been a younger man, I can say they would have likely been drinking no matter what was going on. Because even if the police showed up and 100% believed that the group of men had just encountered something otherworldly, what were the police supposed to say? An armed posse just encountered a monster in the woods, but don't worry, theirs is only the fifth sighting, so no reason to get excited. The police would no doubt scoot them out of the area regardless of what had happened, and in no way would the police be inclined to validate the story and endanger the public's health and state of mind. And this next point, too, I usually take with a grain of salt, but I do think it's important to keep in mind that this area is not one where people are known for their extroversion. And just because the public witnesses were limited doesn't mean that they were, in fact, the only witnesses. It's easy to see why a more conservative, psychologically conservative, community may be tight-lipped about such happenings. I've definitely mused over this with Bigfoot. Is California actually a Bigfoot hotspot? Or are Californians simply more likely to be open about such things? Because remember, seeing a Bigfoot is less than half the battle as far as the making of a report is concerned. Unpopular opinion. I'm actually not too naive. And these five incidents are not particularly compelling for any one reason or another. But the skeptic's argument is just so silly. There's no reason to believe McDaniel lied. No books, no movie deals, only two interviews with small newspapers. and a local radio show. And perhaps he became interested in the paranormal slash extraterrestrial discussion, but I can find no evidence of it. So maybe, just maybe he in fact saw something, quote, not from here. But of course, to the truth makers, he saw a kangaroo. And though clearly clever, the kangaroo theory has a big problem. I don't care if you'd never heard of kangaroos, never saw one, never read about one. This is not something terrifying that you get a gun for. Strange, sure, but not entirely alien. Not unrecognizable on all counts. And perfectly, McDaniel was familiar with kangaroos, and he said a kangaroo it was not, which you'd think wouldn't need to be said. Like if I saw this, and then some sociologist from the university told me that I just saw a kangaroo, I don't even know how I would respond. He said it closed a distance of 50 feet in 3 leaps. For some context, that's 17 feet per bound. Kangaroo and deer can easily hit 25 feet horizontally. Some rabbits can hit 9 feet, and an average house cat can hit a distance of anywhere between 5 and 10 feet. So at least in terms of size, in regards to the creature's physical capacity, his description makes sense in the world we know and mostly understand. And I've read through a lot of stuff that cites this entire incident as an example of hysteria, social contagion, collective behavior, and, quote, an extreme instance of suggestibility. And you know, this is, admittedly, one of the few times that I'm strangely proud of being less than skeptical about such things. Quite honestly, I'd be willing to bet that something strange was going on before I'd bet that this was all a wayward kangaroo coupled with a bunch of sociology words. An extreme instance of suggestibility. The stuff some people will believe. Like I said all the way back in the beginning, this is just a small chapter in the sordid world of the unscrupulous. If I had to find some corroboration with another chapter of the cryptid-verse, it would likely be the chupacabra, simply because they're both anomalous and defy categorization as a whole, and they can't really be linked into anything within the realm of that which is understood in any meaningful way, even though I'd argue that our understanding is less understood than most would admit. Also, both the chupacabra and the Enfield monster don't have much of an origin story or historical background. One day, they just became. This was my take on the Enfield monster. A case that is frustrating because it seems unlikely we'll ever know what really happened one way or another. But there's nothing to me that screams hoax, and certainly nothing to scream misidentification. And perhaps the strongest lesson to learn from this case is just how quickly the skeptics rallied to a conclusion that made just as little sense as the alternative, in my opinion. Anyway, I encourage you to like the video because that really helps me make more of them, and subscribe if you haven't already. And as always, thanks an awful lot for listening.